You know what's really bizarre? Because when I was young, I had to go to London to get signed. I signed to Island Records when, and I had to go to London to get my deal. In America, I was just too bizarre with them. And instantly, Laswell. Because I was doing Bootsy and George Clinton. And first album I ever did was the R&B Skeletons in the Closet. That's George discovered in 1985. So I was tapped in with that whole thing. So Thomas Dolby, Bootsy, and all those guys.
Oh, Thomas Dolby's great too.
Yeah, I used to work with Thomas.
Yeah.
So all those guys looked after me. And but to get a deal, I was too bizarre. So I came to London and I started working with Terence Trent D'Arby and Park Music. And
you did a Hendrix on them.
Well,
I was coming to London. You did a Hendrix on them.
Pretty
basically.
Much,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that's how my whole thing started happening. Was actually coming to the UK and coming. To
you know, when I was doing my first album, Color Code, in New York in 1989, with Bill Laswell, Miles Davis was hanging out in the studio all day and all night one time, and he spoke to me, and I had. He looked at me, and after all night of sitting around all night, I didn't say a word to him. He was just like so like vibey, and he finally walks up to me and he goes, he's like, his head was shaking. He was like talking to me. I could see his eyes, and I couldn't understand a fucking word he said. And to this day, it drives me crazy. And I wasn't gonna dare say it. Excuse me. I just nodded my head. And then he said, wave goodbye, and he left. And it drives me fucking nuts that I. Have no idea what the hell he said to me.
Maybe he said something really important.
He could have said something important. He could have been telling me to fuck off. But he was—he didn't seem like he was being, you know, because a lot of my friends have seen him be really like
rough
with people. And he was being really cool. He was like looking at me. His head was—he was like telling me something. I'm so pissed to this day. I have no idea what he said. But during those sessions, you know, like he was there, Joey Ramone, and then Ronald Shannon Jackson was there, and Ronald was just like the coolest. And I guess I never knew it, but Ronald was studying me, right? Because then he flew me back to New York to do that Red Warriors album. And I said to Ronald the same thing in Bill Laswell that I said to you. I was like, I have no idea anything about jazz. I play by ear, and I don't know the names of the chords and all that I play and all that. And he said, that's okay. Just do what you feel. Do what you feel. So we booked 3 days to do the Red Warrior album, right? And at Platinum Island in New York City. And we got there, and I just started going crazy on the album, you know. Anything. I had no idea in what I was doing. And at one time, I kept thinking to myself, what the fuck am I doing? I'm so lost. I got so lost in the middle of the song. I mean, so lost with all these crazy things that were going on that I took my guitar, and I went against that SSL mixing board, and I went, with my strings, and it was going, it was making all these sounds like someone dying. And I started laughing. And I turned around, and on the couch like this was Bill Laswell and Ronald Shannon Jackson, and they were both like this. They're going, oh, yeah. And I said, oh, fuck. So I kept going, and the song was done. And I thought to myself right then, fucking jazz is bullshit. Because, I mean, I don't even know what the fuck I'm doing. But then Billboard magazine came out, and it said it was the best work Stevie Silas has ever done. And I'm like, it dawned on me that I just don't get it. I have to start thinking on a whole nother level that here I was thinking like this and I'm missing the whole point. So now I always remember that. Those guys being like that, me thinking it was bullshit, and then everyone else reacting to that record in such a way that I must be wrong. They all can't be wrong and I'm
you're
right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
They like what was coming out of your ears.
I was in San Diego as a kid. I was a surfer. And I started playing guitar. And it became very easy for me. And I had a band in high school, and we became really popular, and then I moved to Los Angeles in 1985, and within about 8 months, I was homeless, and that's when I met George Clinton. And George Clinton, I said to George in the studio one night, hey, if you ever need a guitar player, let me know. And just ironically enough, him and David Spradley, the guy that he did Atomic Dog with, woke me up at about 3 a.m, and if you ever talk to George, you see George, bring it up, say, hey, did you wake up Stevie at 3 a.m, he'll tell you the whole story. It's like one of our favorite stories. And I went in the studio and went ballistic on the guitar, and George freaked out, and that's how my career started. It was the R&B Skeletons in the Closet album, and through George, then I met Bootsy Collins, and Bootsy then like loved me. I was Scorpio, and he's a Scorpio. And Bootsy knew that I was full of shit, but he said I reminded him of him, and he took me under his wing, started coming to my house and writing songs with me and working with me, where I ended up doing the album What's Bootsy Doing, you know, with Electro Cuties and all that shit. And therefore, that's how I met Bill Laswell in Detroit that no one knew about, right? So, like, I started getting calls from people like what was his name, Roberta from Climax and all these people. We want to do a session. I'm like, yeah. I'm double scale. And they're like, no problem, man, because, you know, they thought I was some big-time guy. Meanwhile, I was living on a couch, homeless, without any money, and my bluff worked, right? And that's sort of how my career started. Yeah, that's really how my career started. And that's how the whole thing went. And then through Bootsy, I met Don Was and ended up co-producing some of that Was Not Was What Up Dog album, which then brought me to England for the first time, when we had that number one record called Walk the Dinosaur.
Yeah.
And then I produced a song which was called Out Come the Freaks, which was a big hit in the UK.
Yeah.
So everything just kind of
blew from one step to the next.
Then I joined Rod Stewart in 1988, and then I was like Pride of Jets and football stadiums.
Yeah.
Got signed to Island Records, and there you go.
How was it, what about learning to play the guitar? How much, you know, when did you begin actually playing?
I never took a lesson.
No.
I started playing when I was 15. It was kind of late. But I played by ear,
yeah.
And it sort of like was so easy for me in a lot of ways. Like I think like the Star Wars movie, like the Jedi Knight, if I don't think about it, it just comes out. And the minute I put my mind to it and think about it, there's a short circuit and everything's fucked up and my pocket ain't there and all that shit. So it's a bit of an oddity on what it is. But to me, I do the most relatively basic things, I think.
Yeah.
And I still, there's a lot of pure musicians. The real musicians seem to love me, like, you know, the Doug Wimbishes and all those guys,
yeah.
All of the Bootsies, and they've always loved me, worked with me, treated me great.
Yeah.
But a lot of the newer guitar players that study a lot, I don't do any of the tricks like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And they would find me to be irrelevant, I think, and which is fine with me, because I was still selling records, and I still have a record deal even to this day, 20 years later. I still have a record deal.
Well, you're in a big advantage position, aren't you?
Well, maybe.
Well, a lot of people don't have a record deal.
I can't even believe I still have a record deal. I'm so thankful. But I think part of the reason I still have a record deal is because I surround myself with guys like Bernard Fowler, Doug Wimbishon, and T.M. Stevens.
The team you have is important.
It's the most important. I mean, you can collaborate with outstanding people. I'm not afraid of people being better than me. I feel like if they're better, I get better, and I'll hold my own. I'll get in a ring with anybody.
You know, you have no fear of that.
I have no fear of that. As a matter of fact, I invite it. I live for it. I live for that challenge.